Hello, welcome or welcome back to the Yarn and Yarns YouTube channel. My name is Angela and all the places you can find me should be linked in the description box below this video. Here on the channel you'll find me chatting about my adventures in knitting, spinning, crochet, weaving, all of the fibre related things. Now today's video is something that I have been on the fence about sharing because it's been in progress for such a long time. Honestly, if you knew how many videos I've half started and need to do something else to be able to progress the video, I've got so much footage on my computer. Anyway, I've been on the fence about sharing this one. It's a blending board experiment, which then turns into a bit of spinning. And now in the present day, I'm going to be doing some knitting. So the blending and spinning happened back last August, September time, and it's the reason I've been in two minds of sharing it is because when I've watched the footage back, oh my goodness, like my techniques on the blending board, this was my second ever attempt at using the blending board, and they're just a little bit cringeworthy to me now, having made so many more rolags and gotten so much better. It's also some of the first footage that I filmed on my new camera, so there are a few dodgy things going on with the sound and the camera angles and things like that. So on the one hand I'm thinking, oh, is this just too much of a hot mess to share? But on the other hand, one of the things that I really have enjoyed doing on the channel in the past is sharing me doing things when I'm a beginner or practically a beginner, because there are lots of videos out there on YouTube filmed by people who are much more practiced in doing these techniques. But I think sometimes once you do get more practice at doing them, you kind of forget the things that were hurdles or difficult for you when you first started. One of the reasons I like to share my first steps into things is because the experience is kind of live, fresh in my mind. I'm able to share sort of thoughts and feelings as I'm doing it. Yeah, I hope that process helps other people who are beginners too, because it can be a little bit demoralizing sometimes when you watch, say, a blending board video and someone is making these beautiful rolags or a beautiful bat on their blending board and everything just goes smoothly because they know what they're doing. And then you try and maybe, like me, you struggle to get your rolags off the board, or the fiber doesn't stick to the board in the way that you want it to. All sorts of things. So yeah, I hope it's kind of useful for me to share these beginner steps. So I decided I would share it anyway, despite the slightly cringeworthy and embarrassing things, or what seem to be slightly embarrassing things to me now. So coming up is footage of my second ever blending board experiment. And once you've seen that footage, I'm actually going to come back and several months later knit the yarn. And finally round off this video. So let me hand you over to Ange of the past. Today's video is a little bit of a continuation of my blending board series. If you have been here on the channel for a little while, you'll know that I recently picked up a Ashford blending board and I shared my first attempt at making rolags on that board. And in that video, I blended up some fibre and we spun up the rolags that I made. This footage that you're seeing now is me, rather inexpertly, as you can see, trying to lay down fibre for my second batch of rolags. So I still have quite some way to go to get these techniques down, but I think it's always fun to share the journey. So yes, I'm hoping in this video that we are going to make some rolags and spin up those rolags. And I'm also going to be experimenting a little bit around what happens to the rolags when we ply them in different ways and how that ultimately affects the look of the yarn that we're producing. So by the end of this video, I hope to have a few knitted swatches to share with you. And I'm hoping this will help to inform me about how I want to use the board in the future and what sort of yarns that I might be aiming to make. So yeah, just a little bit of fun experimentation and play on the blending board today. As you can see, I am laying down my first layer of fiber. These rolags I'm calling the Grainbow Rolags, and it's basically a combination of the grey fibre that you can see me working with now, and in a little while we'll start laying down some coloured fibre over the top. So the grey fibre that I'm using is Corriedale fibre. The second fibre, which you can see me unbraiding now, I purchased from a dyer here in the UK called Chimera Crafting, and I've had this rainbow braid in my stash for quite some time, and the base is BFL, Blueface Leicester, and I thought because of the fun colours, this would be a really nice one to split down and use on my blending board. So as you can see, I'm just pulling out chunks of the different colours and I'm getting ready to lay those out across my board. So I'm just going to be popping those on top of the grey fibre in sort of rainbow colour order. I shall be sharing my thoughts and what I've learnt from my couple of experimentations on the board. I've already learnt a few things, so I'll be chatting about those a little bit later. And yeah, we're just going to have some fun and a little bit of playtime. So I'm going to leave you with a little bit of footage of me laying the colours across this board, and I think I'll probably speed that footage up, otherwise we might be here for quite some time. Once I've made the layers, I will come back and chat to you a little bit more. So I have my coloured layer of fibre down on the board now. I did speed up that last section of footage, so I'm not sure how well you will have been able to see exactly what was going on. But in my excitement to get started on this project, I started laying the colour down on the board without really much thought as to what I wanted my finished rolags to look like. And as a consequence, I ended up, instead of putting one repeat of the rainbow across the board, I had got to my blue stripe, which was kind of the end stripe, as I was just approaching halfway across the board. So I ended up popping a double rainbow spread of colours to fill up the whole board. However, that did mean that because I hadn't thought about the placement, that I was slightly over the halfway mark on the board, so in order to fit a full colour repeat again, I had to end up pulling some fibre off the board and relaying it. So I'm not sure how well that came across in the footage, but I thought that was worth mentioning. So definitely something for future me to be aware of when I'm working on the board again. If I'm looking at making some sort of striped yarn in a particular colour sequence, then I might need to just be a little bit more aware of how much space each striped segment is taking up on the board if I want to get an even spread. For this yarn, as I say, it's just a bit of experimentation, so it really wasn't the end of the world. And in actual fact, the process of doing this and me ending up with a double rainbow is what has led me to think about experimenting with the plying and the knitting up. So out of a little bit of an experiment without pre-planning has come something which I think is going to be quite a nice learning experience for me, because as I was rolling the rolags off the board, it kind of occurred to me that because I had made such thin stripes of the colour, when I go to spin the yarn, I'm actually going to be getting really short colour repeats, which obviously is going to affect how the yarn looks when it's knitted up. So that kind of led me to thinking about being maybe a little bit more intentional with the board in future, and to also thinking about doing this experiment so that hopefully it will inform me in the future if I'm aiming to make a particular type of yarn. So as you can see, I popped on another layer of the grey fibre, another layer of the colour fibre. I just kept layering up the fibres until the board was reasonably full. Now, I have been given some advice not to load the board too full if you want, you know, nice sort of consistent rolags. I possibly put a little bit too much fibre on this for some people's tastes, but the rolags are coming off mostly fine. As you can see, I managed to stretch and split one there as I was trying to pull the dowels out. But I have learnt a couple of things since my first experiment that I think it would be worth mentioning here. So as you can see, I now have a non-slip mat underneath my blending board. My table that I'm using here is a glass top table, and I was having trouble with it sliding around on the board, on the table I should say, when I was trying to pull the rolags off in the last video. So the non-slip mat is working wonders to help me do that. The other thing that I found in the first video that was a real struggle was this step, so actually pulling the rolags off the board, and I still haven't got that completely off pat, but this time was a lot better. And it might be a little bit difficult for me to try and explain, but in the first video, as I was wrapping my fibre around the rolags, I was trying to pull the fibre straight back, so I was trying to draft it out straight back across the board. But what I have learnt now is to make things a little bit easier, instead of just pulling back, I need to pull slightly up and back, so I need to tip my hands forward a little bit more, and that obviously lifts the fibre. It's obvious now that I'm thinking about it, but that lifts the fibre off of those teeth that are grasping the fibre to the board, and it just makes it a whole lot easier to draft back and wind the rolags. Before, I was fighting against the teeth because I wasn't angling up my hands enough to make it easier for the fibre to come off the teeth. I still haven't got it entirely smoothly. This attempt was much, much better. So each attempt from here on in will hopefully get better and better still, and it'll be a lot less work on my hands and my wrists, and my thumbs in particular were quite achy after that first experiment, just because I was really pushing down on them, trying to sort of drag the fibre off the board. The other thing that's slightly different in this attempt is, and it may not be quite so obvious looking at the video now, but maybe if you remember, or if you go back to watch the first video, you might see what I mean. I had quite a lot of sort of scraggly loose fibres at the top of my board, and that was because as I was laying the fibre down on the board, I was kind of overlapping and overhanging the fibre off of the top of the board, and that left a really sort of scruffy edge to my last rolag. As you can see, I'm trying to pull off the final rolag now, and although I haven't entirely solved that problem, this rolag is a lot neater than the top rolag that I pulled off of the first batch, and that is because I was consciously trying not to let the fibres overlap the top of the board so much. I have watched a couple of videos on making rolags since my first attempt, and I have noticed that some folks actually leave the very top of the fibre on their board, so they don't roll the entirety off, which means that any unevenness at the top of the board is obviously not incorporated into your rolag. And I think that people sometimes save those sort of leftover bits and pieces and put them in a scrap bag to make sort of random rolags later. But as these are just for me, I'm not really worried about making my rolags super consistent. Time for the spinning section of this video. It's been a while since I made those rolags, and actually I made a big pile of them, forgot to take any footage of them, but I think I do have a photograph of the number of rolags that I ended up making, so if I still have that available, then I'll pop that in here so you can see the end results of my blending. So since then, I have been working away on spinning up some of the rolags, and I've got a couple of spindles full. I am using my support spindles to spin up these rolags. Rolags are a lovely woolen preparation, and you spin long draw on support spindles, so it's a perfect combination. And I've filled up two of my support spindles with, I think there's two rolags on here each, so hopefully you can see they're spinning up nicely. I have found them really easy to spin, and I think that's testament to the quality of the lovely fibre that went onto the board rather than anything to do with my blending skills. I also have another little nugget that I've spun up, and I was testing out a new spindle that I had, but I also wanted to use that spindle for another spin, so I've got another little ball of singles here, and I've got one rolag left to spin. So I'm going to sit and spin that now, and then we can think about a couple of different methods for plying. I don't suppose it really matters, but I think I started with the red end and went through to the blue. So I'm trying to keep these consistent, but it's been a while since I've spun those first two spindles. So yeah, I'm pretty sure I started with the red end and went through to the blue. So I shall sit and spin this now. Finished spinning the singles now for the six rolags of the Grainbow set that I kept for myself, and so I'm ready to start thinking about plying these up. So here we go, I've got all of my spindles reasonably full. So these two Enid Ashcroft that you saw that I'd already finished, I also have this little Nugget which is one rolags worth, and this is the Woodland Woodworking spindle that I was filling up yesterday. So apologies for any background noise you can hear. I think there must be a helicopter or a plane flying over. I am going to ply up some of these as a three ply to try and keep the sort of colour progression as it was in the rolags, and I'm going to be spinning up some of these as a two ply. I'm just going to randomly two ply them together and see what we get. And I may even, I'm not sure yet whether I'm going to two-ply from the different colour ends to really mix the colours up, or whether I'm just going to two-ply from the same end and just see. I think I might two-ply from the same end and see how well the colours match up. Each of my rolags, I didn't take any steps to make them the same kind of weight, so I'm sure there'll be crossovers where the colours in the two-ply don't sort of match up evenly, but the three-ply is where I'm hoping to sort of keep that colour progression. My first step is going to be to wind these off of the spindles and then to figure it out from there. All wound up. I'm going to, so there's four rolags in total in these two, so I'm going to chain ply these, and then these are the two single rolags, so I'm going to two ply those together in a traditional two ply sense, where I just hold one strand from this one and one strand from this one together and keep going until one of them runs out. And I think I'm going to sit and ply on my wheel. Thank you. Okay, so I've got my 2-ply on the Niddy Noddy and my 3-ply on the bobbin, and I'm loving the look of that beautiful round 3-ply. I've actually got some more of the yarn that I caked up that I haven't yet plied, so that's only 2 rolags worth of 3-ply on there, and I've still got 2 rolags worth on here. But my thinking now is this should be plenty to knit into a little sample, so I'm going to save the other sort of larger ball and decide once I've done my knitted swatch whether to make a little bit more of the 2 or the 3-ply once I've done my knitting and decide which yarn I actually like best. But my gut feeling at the moment is I'm going to make some more of this, but we will see. And back to the present day, which currently, I'm not sure when this video will go up, but currently is at the end of March 2022. And I have had these 2 little finished skeins of yarn sat on my desk over there for months, just staring at me, waiting to be knit up into a swatch or something, which is what I always planned, or how I always planned to end this video. And now I am thinking these might be the perfect thing to knit up my March gnomes. So if you followed the channel this year, you'll know that I'm trying to participate in Imagined Landscapes Year of the Gnomes. So every month you knit one of the Imagined Landscape gnome patterns, basically. And it is, there's only a couple of days of March left as I'm recording this, and it's crunch time, I need to cast on. So I'm going to be knitting the really basic gnome and the smallest version, and I thought actually this would be the perfect time to use these 2 yarns and finish this video too. So I've got my 3-ply, which should to a certain extent kind of be a self-striping, because I tried to keep the colour progression of the colours as I blended them up in my rolags. And then I've got this 2-ply, which is a much more mild yarn because the colours didn't stay matched for a very long time. So I thought I could make one of these the body, one of these the hat. I'll probably use the 2-ply, I think, for the hat, and then the 3-ply for the body. So hopefully this will give us a good demonstration of how 2 yarns made from the same set of rolags but plied in different ways can make 2 different looking yarns, or at least I hope they will. I haven't knit them yet, so this is all theoretical. This is all what I'm expecting to happen. I guess the next few minutes of this video will show what actually is going to happen. So yeah, let's get knitting. Rainbow hat to share with you. So it's been a beautiful afternoon and I've been sitting in the garden, and here is my little hat from the 2-ply skein of yarn. And I lied to you earlier because I'm not knitting the smallest gnome. This is actually the largest gnome from the Never Not Gnoming pattern. I couldn't resist. The smaller gnome, the hat would have cut off around about here somewhere, and I still have plenty of yarn left, so I decided just to go for it. Though it does mean I might be playing a little bit of yarn chicken with the body, because I think there's probably, although I've got a few more grams of the 3-ply yarn, there might not be quite as much yardage because of the 3-ply nature making it slightly thicker, but we shall see. Really love how this little hat knit up, and it has a sort of very gentle, subtle sort of change through the rainbow colours, because, well, for 2 reasons. Obviously the grey mutes down the bright colours that I used in the fibre to start with, and you can definitely see some sort of marling where you get one strand of colour and one strand of grey in various parts of the yarn. But also where the 2-ply, the colours didn't match up, it's kind of a mixing and merging the colours together for a subtle sort of fade gradient type effect. So yeah, this was really fun to knit with, and it might be swaying my mind. I've still got that one quantity of singles left that I haven't actually plied up, and I thought that I would be erring on the side of the 3-ply, but this has me second guessing my sort of initial reaction. Maybe I would want another little mini skein of this yarn, but time will tell. It's time to wind up the 3-ply and get knitting on the little body. And there's still some sunshine left, so yeah, let's do this. Finished. So time finally for my final thoughts. I'm saying finally because this project for me has been about 6 months in the making. From blending up that fibre through to spinning the yarn and then knitting the yarn. So many things that I have in progress and not enough hours in the day to do them all. Anyway, when we last spoke, I was just about to pick up a knit for the body with the 3-ply yarn, and as I suspected, the 3-ply has got a much more defined stripe to it than the 2-ply. So if I hold up the back of the gnome, you might be able to see that a little bit better. I think the red stripe down here in particular shows it quite well, because the red, at least to my eye on camera, is really quite bright, whereas the red parts up here are much more muted because the colours have blended together a little bit more in the plying process. So they are fairly similar, but there are marked differences. And because I wasn't careful at the outset to try and make my rolag reasonably similar in terms of the weight of fibre that I was pulling off in each rolag, the stripes on the body are nowhere near even. There's a teeny tiny little red stripe here and then a much bigger red stripe here, where obviously one of the rolags that I had was much fuller of fibre and another one was obviously a little bit lighter on the fibre. So yeah, lots of food for thought in this little video. It's been really fun experimenting with the same set of rolags and plying up in different ways and knitting it up into one project to see the sort of similarities and the differences in the yarn. Out of this one little project, I've learnt a lot about how I might want to approach future sessions on the blending board if I'm aiming to make a particular type of yarn, how I might want to lay that on the board, how I might want to ply it once I've spun it. Yeah, all sorts of things to think about, which for a fun little experiment is, yeah, it's just been really, really nice and really thought-provoking. I can't really think of how else to articulate what I'm feeling, but yeah, I've learnt a lot from a small amount of fibre, I guess, just approached in slightly different ways, which is just fascinating. I love how there's always something new to learn from our adventures in fibre crafts. Finished off my gnome with a little scrap of handspun yarn that, again, I blended up. I think I might blended it on my drum carder. A little bit of Corriedale fibre with some neon dyed trilobal nylon, so there are some subtle neon pops in Gnome's beard. I don't think that's showing up particularly well on the camera in today's light, but it is a little bit more obvious in person. Now, I still have this little quantity of singles, which I originally said I was going to wait and decide whether I wanted more of this yarn or more of this yarn. But what I didn't take into account was, really, if I wanted more of this 2-ply yarn, what I would have needed to have done was to keep, rather than spin up lots of rolags into one quantity, I would have needed to have kept the rolags separately, because I just spun 2 rolags for this and plied from the same end. I could, of course, make a 2-ply from this centre pole ball, but I'm going to be plying from opposite ends, which means the colours won't merge in the same way. So rather than get sort of like red on red and then the colours sort of subtly changing depending on sort of what quantity of each colour was in each rolag, I'm going to be plying if I plied a 2-ply with this, I'm going to be plying a red end with a blue end, so that could be a third completely different yarn from one rolag experiment, which might be something fun to do in the future. But for now, I need to stop and wrap up this video, otherwise we'll be here for another 6 months before I get it up on the channel and share this process and my thoughts with you. So yeah. But yeah, more food for thought. I might do that another time. So time for me to say goodbye to you today. I hope you've enjoyed the video. It's been a little bit of a chaotic mess, and as I said at the start, some of this has been a little bit cringeworthy for me to share in terms of both editing and sound, and also just sharing my very haphazard technique on the blending board. As I mentioned at the start, this was just my second ever attempt at blending up some rolags on that blending board, so my techniques have much improved, or I like to think so, since then. So yeah, a little bit embarrassing to share that footage with you, but hey, it's done now. I hope you won't judge me too harshly. I love playing on the blending board, and so I'm sure this will not be the last blending board video that I have up here on the channel. If you've got any thoughts or suggestions of what experiments you might like to see me throw onto the blending board in future, then please do let me know in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. And you are a spinner, or and you engage in your own fibre prep, I'd love to know, do you have favourite colours to play with or favourite fibre blends? Yeah, I always just love to chat with you and be inspired by your making adventures too. I'll be back again soon here on the channel with some more making adventures, so I hope you all join me for the next video. But until we do get to spend time together again, I hope you get to do some other things that you enjoy. Great big woolly hugs to you all. Bye for now.